deeply regret it.
Well, I want to take.
There was a piece of her.
And every.
I deeply regret. Yeah, I made him three chicken breasts. Yeah, he is. I do, yeah.
Madam Clerk, are we good to go?
According to my clock, you've got 1 minute before seven. Oh, it just changed. Now you're good to go.
Are we good to go for live stream?
Good evening and welcome to the Planning and Development Committee meeting of Monday, March 6, 2023. My name is Regional Councillor Maurice Brenner and I have the pleasure of chairing tonight's meeting. Madam Clerk, roll call.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I can certify the attendance of all members of council who are all participating in person.
Thank you. Are there any disclosures of interest? None duly noted. Delegations, and we have one delegation. And I'd like to call the delegate forward, Michael. And I just remind you of our rules, and that is 10 minutes.
Perfect.
And then questions by the committee.
Thank you. Good evening, members of council. Oh, that's the last slide.
Thank you very much. I said you were going to be short. I didn't mean that short.
You said 10 minutes.
Good evening, members of committee. My name is Michael Testaguza from the Bigley Area Group. Here to provide a presentation with regards to the applications at 1970 Brock Road with respect to official plan amendment and zoning bylaw amendment applications. I'd like to start off by saying I have reviewed the staff report and do agree with its conclusions. So I'm here just to give you a very brief, hopefully, presentation and answer any questions you may have. So design of this site is based on three critical elements. First, the site and its immediate context, the larger context of the site, as well as the planning context for the site. So I'll go over the three of those quickly. With respect to the subject site itself, it's located at the northwest corner of Brock Road and Kingston Road. It contains four existing commercial buildings with a roughly 1,800 meter squared of commercial uses therein, as well as the designated heritage resource, which is the Post Manor. On the north end of the site, particularly notable, and on the west end, is an existing hedge of mature trees. And then to the north and the west are three-story townhouse units. To the immediate west is another commercial plaza. The broader context of the subject site includes a variety of community uses, including recreational opportunities, both passive and active, as well as retail commercial uses, schools, and other community services and facilities. In addition, the site is right on the Kingston BRT, which obviously provides it broad access to the wealth of services existing across the corridor. And lastly, of course, the Brock Corridor, which does also provide bus connection directly to the GO station. Lastly is the planning context. And the planning context has always called for mixed-use, high-density development on the site. The regional official plan designates Kingston as a regional corridor. The in-force OP designates the site as a mixed-use corridor. And the OPA 38 policies that were recently endorsed by council designate the site mixed use type A, which is where the highest density and intensity of uses are expected to be located in the corridor. Further, the site's designated as a gateway within the corridor and located at one of only two transit junctions per OPA 38. OPA 38 allows for a maximum density of 5.0 and a maximum height of 35 stories. So moving on to the proposal, I'll try to build out how we got to where we got to based on what we just spoke about. So the proposal includes three different types of built forms. On the north and the west end of the site are four-story stacked towns immediately adjacent to the existing townhomes to the north and the west. As one moves southward, you have a 12-story mid-rise building followed by a 30-story tower. Now, the tower and the mid-rise building are connected by a six-story podium. Fronting onto Kingston Road, as well as fronting onto the plaza via both the mixed-use podium, but also the mid-rise building, the eastern facade of it, as well as the Post Manor, these all contain retail commercial uses, which in total are approximately 1,800 meters squared in area. So all of the commercial space that is to be removed through the application is to be put back on site. Further, the Post Manor is obviously being retained at the far eastern portion of the site, being moved over 17 meters. That movement has been reviewed by an expert in heritage buildings and has been confirmed both to be feasible and also advisable through the redevelopment of the site to ensure that it's on a solid foundation during construction. At the corner of Kingston and Brock is also located a proposed POPS, publicly accessible, privately owned amenity space, which will front onto the commercial uses in the mixed-use podium of the mid-rise and high-rise building, as well as the Post Manor itself. Now, as we mentioned, there is a neighborhood and existing townhomes to the north and the west. So it was important to consider in the design of the site transition. Now, we spoke about the Kingston guidelines allowing up to 35 stories and 5.0 FSI. The development proposes a 4.4 FSI and a height of only 30 stories. And the transition is one element of this. You can see on the image on the right, the proposal respects a 45 degree angular plane from the neighborhood to the north, and it does also to the west. The reason for a 45 degree angular plane, it's a tool that planners use to ensure minimization of overlook and shadowing. And so you'll see through the shadow studies, as they were described in the staff report and our planning report, shadowing on the neighbors to the west and the north is very minimal, a maximum of 2 hours on any given space. And that's largely a result of the angular plane being respected. And you can see that on the image to the right. The other thing the image to the right shows is the three different forms, built forms that were employed on the site to also create that transition from towns backing onto towns up to a mid-rise. And because of the depth of the site in the far southwest corner, enough room for a tall building to be located thereon. Another element of the transition is obviously those mature trees and making sure that the existing foliage separating the two uses was maintained. Along the northern and western property boundary, only three trees are proposed to be removed, and two of them are already dead. In essence, the trees along the north and the western property lines are going to be maintained, which will maintain the privacy of those users to the immediate west and north. Lastly, and I am going to spend a little bit more time here, but it is very important to this development, is the Post Manor itself. The Post Manor is proposed to be retained on site and moved 17 meters eastward towards Brock Road. This was recommended by our heritage consultant with respect to feasibility to ensure that the building can maintain on the landscape for the long period of time. The reason for this is that it needs to be put on a new foundation while the new buildings would be constructed to ensure that it remains stable over time. So that's the reason for the building moving eastward. It also increases the prominence of the building, both from Kingston Road and from Brock Road. Now, it's important to note that the Heritage Conservation Strategy that was developed by ERA was approved or was supported by the Heritage Committee. The heritage conservation strategy has been a central driver in the design of the development from the start. Working closely with ERA, our heritage consultants, we've developed an approach that both conserves the heritage resource on site and actually helps it reclaim a more supportive setting than it's been in the last century, half century, sorry. Early on, we undertook a review of the Post Manor's original setting on a farmstead, which is the image you see on the left, and its current setting in the 20th century in the middle of a parking lot in a retail plaza, which is what you see on the right. As a farmstead, the site included many of the typological features of a historic Ontario farmstead, including the farm itself, but also the barns and outbuildings, a linear entrance driveway framed by vegetation, mature trees in the front yard and rear fields, and windrows along the property line. In essence, this was a farmhouse on a farm. As Pickering developed, the farm was subdivided, and almost all of those elements are no longer on the landscape other than the home itself, which is what you see on the image to the right. So one of the key goals of the project was not only to conserve, but to enhance the farmhouse and the setting around it. As a mitigation measure for the relocation of Post Manor and the construction of taller buildings in its proximity, ERA designed a landscape strategy for the site that would interpret the elements of the historic Ontario farmstead and would restore softness and greenery to the historic setting. And that is the concept plan that we have on the screen right now. And it has three key zones that we want to key in on. The first is the zone around the farmhouse itself, which includes interpretive elements like a front fence and a gate and a rear kitchen garden. Then we have the farmstead lane, which is just to the north of the house. The farmstead lane leading past the house leads into the new community behind it, which includes interpretive landscape treatments such as a wagon track paving to provide design reference to a rural farm lane. And then lastly is the centerpiece of the proposal, or one of it, which is the pop space, which we're terming as Post Corner. Post Corner Plaza is a green space located at the corner of Kingston and Brock Road, which not only ensures the house's visibility, but also that it's seen through a frame of trees and green landscape, which you'll see in this slide right here. Part of the design of the plaza is to ensure that Post Corner be both contemporary, include elements of a historic that support the historic farmhouse, but also include landscape design, such as berming, which you see here, that is to provide a bit of shelter and noise attenuation for those users of the plaza. And that's obviously augmented and supported by the fact that the parking garage for the building is not proposed to be located under either Post Corner or the Heritage House. So that Heritage House can have mature trees growing behind it and providing some relief and distance between the high density development to the west and both the plaza itself, as well as the heritage resource. And this last slide shows you what kind of programming can possibly happen in that space and gives you a sense of scale as well. When you're looking at a plan from an overhead view, you can't really always picture what could happen there, nor how large that space actually is. So the space is 800 meters squared. And as you can see here, it has three different varieties of use as we see it. On a day over day basis, it has the ability for passive recreation, as you see on the left side, but also the ability for spillover uses from the adjacent commercial uses in the mixed use podium. And that could include seating if there was a restaurant there, but also, as you see on the third image on the slide, could also include community events, farmers gardens, art gallery shows, things of that nature. And that is one last thing I'd like to add. The list of commercial uses on the site is very broad, and we worked with staff to develop it. In speaking with some members of the committee, it was identified that an art gallery would also be a potential great use for that site. And my client is definitely very interested in that idea, and would ask that that use be added between committee and council to the draft bylaw. Happy to take any questions from the committee at this point.
Thank you very much. Members of the committee, Councillor...
Thank you, Chair Brenner. Thank you. Through you to the delegation. Thank you for your presentation. A couple things. This proposal has changed considerably since it was originally submitted. Just for our update and for any residents that may be tuning in or tuning in later, can you describe the major changes that have occurred that would be most noticeable or noteworthy to committee and to residents?
Certainly. So the proposal, and I'd like to note that it changed in response to both several meetings we had with area residents, but also as the Kingston Road intensification plan updated as it went through council. So there were a number of changes, and I'll run through them. The first was decreasing the amount of towers. So there was previously two tall buildings. One was located directly at the intersection of Kingston Road and Brock Road. In essence, one of those towers was removed. And now we're down to one tower. And instead of where the old tower was located, you have the post corner Pops Plaza. The second is a decrease in units from 860 to 675. The total height of the project also decreased from 34 to 30 stories. And that height was changed slightly in its massing to ensure that it was completely outside of the angular plane, whereas previously a small portion of that western tower did pierce the angular plane. In addition, the amount of commercial space increased from just over 1,400 square meters to 1,800 square meters to achieve complete replacement of all commercial area. And lastly, the parking ratios were increased. They were previously proposed at the same rate as the city center, and are now proposed in line with the approvals that were given to smart centers just to the east.
Thank you. And you mentioned some of those changes occurred after speaking to residents, but also staff and members of council, members of this committee. commercial space. I thought I heard you say 1,800 square feet, but you
square meant meters.
Square meters.
Correct.
So it's actually 18,000 square feet.
Correct.
So what kind of uses do you envision here to occupy that commercial space?
Certainly. So there's a very wide range of uses that are permitted in or could be permitted through the draft zoning bylaw that's before you today. It includes a broad range of service commercial uses, but also office uses, retail uses. They'd be primarily located along the Kingston corridor in the six-story podium at grade. And the way the six-story podium is designed is actually quite interesting. So it's set back 4.5 meters at grade. So there's a significant space there for patios or spillover uses. But then there's actually a 1.5 meter overhang of the building above that to provide some weather protection to those spaces so that they could be used all year round, or certainly when there's inclement weather. And then likewise, obviously, there's plenty of spillover space into the pops at the corner. And were that building to turn into an art gallery, there certainly could be all types of supportive uses around that as well. The Post Manor, it's important to note, would also be permitted for commercial uses, and that's what's expected to go over there in the long term.
Is the Post building included in the 1,800 square meters?
Yes, yeah. It is. And it's included in the 1,800 square meters that currently exist as well. So it's an apples to apples comparison.
Okay, thank you. The north and west side of the property are adjacent to existing developments there. So I think you said that a majority of trees will be retained. There's some dead ones. You'll replace the dead ones with similar species, if not as big?
Of course, yes, exactly.
Okay. And with the existing tree line, less the ones that have to come out, and the angular plane of the building, I'm expecting that if you're sitting in that backyard, or if you're sitting at the top of that building, the trees would be sufficient that you're not going to see each other for the most part. They are coniferous trees, to be clear. They're not deciduous.
Exactly. A majority of them are coniferous. I mean, anyone who frequents the area would know that. So certainly they'll be there year round. And certainly based on their proximity, sitting right at the property line and being mature and dense and tall as they are, you would expect that, yes, exactly, they would provide for a significant amount of privacy in those existing rear yards. The other thing, of course, being that our proposed setbacks are actually, and I should have mentioned this in the presentation, are either the same as or greater than the existing townhouse setbacks to their rear yards. And that's because we have to protect the mature foliage. So we actually end up with larger setbacks than the existing towns.
Okay. The two driveways, one onto Brock Road, one onto Kingston Road, are they both right in, right out? You're not suggesting a turning move where you'd be coming from the underground parking, going east to Brock Road, and then trying to get on Brock Road south to the 401? Or is that a possible turning move? Because you would actually come out into a turn lane, so you'd have to get across the turn lane into the southbound lane. During traffic, I don't think you'd make it, but what is the prediction there?
So both are right in, right out in the long term. That's the proposal. That's the way the traffic study was run. Of course, the one on Kingston Road would currently be full moves. It's going to be restricted to right in, right out only once the BRT comes through.
Yeah.
So you can make a right out. We're talking about the Brock entrance, correct?
Yes.
So there is the ability to make a right out from the Brock entrance and go southbound. Our traffic consultant did perform a series of sight distance analysis at that intersection, as well as forecasted how many trips would be heading south and making that right, and then attempting to make a left onto Kingston. And it was something like 17, I believe, during the peak period, 17 to 20, who may attempt that movement. But they noted that there's over 200 meters of straight clear distance to be able to view, so that there would be plenty of, you know, available sight lines such that that movement wouldn't be made in a dangerous manner.
Okay, thanks. So I know you elaborated on the Farmstead Lane and the Post Manor, and that looks great. And I know a number of comments came in about Heritage, and I'm kind of excited about all that. It's open. So POPS, just to go over that again, it's privately owned, but it's open to the public.
Correct.
Maybe I've got that acronym the wrong way around, but so it's privately owned and maintained, but people who don't live there can come sit, have a cup of coffee, walk around the lane, walk their dog, do whatever. It's open to the public.
That's exactly it. And I actually think you got the long form correct, and I had it backwards. It is privately owned, publicly accessible space. So it would be maintained by the condo corp over the long term, but presumably through the site plan process, the city would take an easement over it for public use.
Requires a city easement. Possibly. Okay. That answers part of my question. So Poets Corner.
Poets Corner. You never know what goes into the Heritage Building.
Right now, that area is basically the parking lot south of the Post Manor. That's a paved parking lot. So that would be made into a pedestrian or a public area, which I think is a good thing. Would it be green, or would it be interlocked, you know, set chairs and tables out on, or a combination of? What is your, or is that a site plan detail yet to be worked out?
It is both a site plan detail, but something we did put a lot of thought into as we were moving to the Heritage Committee. So you do see some precedent examples there. So the idea would be that it would both have hardscape that allows for infiltration of groundwater, considering there's no parking below, but also a significant amount of green foliage. The reason for the trees in that space is both to provide relief to the Heritage Building, a sense of kind of differentiation from the high-rise development to the west as proposed. So you're going to have large tree growth in there because they can go all the way down to the middle of the earth with their roots. So you'll have a combination of both because you do want to have the ability for people to be in there as well.
Okay. Last question. The commercial space is going to have a number of at surface dedicated parking for customers. I mean, there could be a convenience store, it could be a dry cleaner, it could be somebody picking up coffee or even wanting to sit out back and have a coffee. There's enough dedicated spots.
Yeah, I'm actually slightly embarrassed. Most of this was in my presentation and I glanced over it. So you can see on this slide here, actually, in between the mid-rise and the tall building, you'll see 16 at-grade parking spaces. So those would be dedicated to users of the commercial space. So they'd be signed for short-term parking for people to come in, you know, use the commercial use and then leave, not for employees. Then there'd be additional overflow parking in the underground if those 16 spaces were to be full. So the parking ratios that are proposed are exactly the same as those that were accepted for smart centers. So ranging from between 3 to 5 per 100 meters squared, depending on the use type. But if you see that that central courtyard for parking there, the entrance to the underground is located immediately to the west. So the great thing about this is the usability of it. You are going to a commercial unit on site. You see the parking there. It's full. That's great for the commercial tenants. Perfect. We're good. But where do you go next? The entrance to the underground's right there, and that's on the first level where the additional visitor and commercial parking will be.
Okay. Thank you. And I started off by asking about the changes because this has changed significantly since we were first presented with it. Since we first had open house discussions with some of the residents, many, many concerns have been addressed. There's been many improvements made. I mean, if people don't like a tall building, they don't like a tall building, but there's been a lot of changes made to this application. I think it's much better in front of us this evening than it was when it started out to middle of last term of council or whenever it was. So thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Councillor Batt.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Through you, Michael, you mentioned the heritage building we moved 17 meters away. And will that be its permanent location or will that be a temporary move?
So the 17 meters east is the permanent location, but it's a two-phase plan because the building is to be repositioned partially in its current location. The rear would be in the front in essence, right? You need to move the building westward, construct a new foundation for it, and then move it eastward into its final location. So that would be in the early phases of construction. What you would do is pick up the building, move it to the west, construct a new foundation 17 meters forward from its current location, and then put it on the new foundation so that it's on a stable base while the construction is occurring on site.
When we talk about heritage building, how old is the building?
Oh, Post Manor. I'm embarrassed to say I don't know the exact age. I know it's over 100 years. I do have my heritage consultant on the line, I believe. Do we have Emma on the line?
Yes, I'm here.
Perfect. So, Emma, do you know exactly how old Post Manor is? Not to put you on the spot.
Yes, it's between, no problem. It's between 1840 and 1842.
Thank you.
So building of that.
I can also say.
Go ahead.
Sorry, I was just going to also say that one of the other reasons for the two-step relocation is so that the shoring for the parking, for the below-grade parking, can happen while the building is sitting in the middle of the site before it gets relocated to its final location.
Okay. Well, I'm a little concerned in terms of having a building move, with that age, being in two different locations, and also construction machines going on and pounding of that. I mean, how comfortable are we that we do not damage the heritage building?
Emma, I'll let you take that one. You know it far better than me, and I know we went.
I'm happy to answer this as well. So in order to answer that exact question, in between the first submission and the second and this past submission, we engaged a building mover at McCulloch Building Movers. They do the vast majority of the building relocation for the sites that we work on. And And they did an assessment. They did a site visit, an assessment of the site, and determined that this would be feasible to relocate. The other reason that the sort of two-step relocation that I was alluding to, the first step actually moves the house all the way to the very center of the site, so that the shoring, which is kind of the most invasive in terms of the type of shaking and disruption that you're talking about, is happening as far away from the building as possible. It's happening really along the perimeter. And between that and kind of the perimeter fencing that happens during that shoring, we've determined that this can happen feasibly. We've relocated buildings of this era before and of this type of material before.
And just to add on to what Emma said, because Emma's very experienced with this and she does it all the time. From my a little bit more of a layman's approach with respect to moving heritage buildings, it was actually the building mover's recommendation that this happen for the safety of the building, which could sound counterintuitive, but that was actually their recommendation to us, rather than moving it directly to its final location, for all the safety reasons that Emma just mentioned.
Right. Moving forward, you were apparently working with community area residents who actually live on Guild Road and Roadwall, actually traffic concerns. I just wonder if that's been addressed and if the community was quite happy within the answers you had to respond.
So we had a series of five working group meetings with the residents that attended, I believe, the community open house some time ago. So each condo corp sent two representatives and then we worked with them and they relayed it back to their community. One of those meetings was specifically on the traffic piece. So we had a full hour and a half time slot to talk about it. We primarily, one of the concerns or the larger concerns was Royal Road and Guild. And we actually, although the region never asked us to study those roads, coming into the meeting, we understood that was an issue. So we did bring that information and we did extend our analysis to those roads. I actually have my traffic consultant on the line as well, who can maybe provide some insight with respect to the findings on both Guild and Royal. Hoping this is going to work twice. Michael, are you there? Going once.
Michael, you're over the 10-minute mark, which means that for you to continue, I would need a...
No, it's the question she already asked. He's already done his presentation.
Madam Clerk, I've delayed message for me.
Yeah, the question period is in addition to the 10 minutes, so we're okay.
We're okay. Thank you.
Oh,
okay. Thank you.
So it seems like Michael's not available, which is perfectly fine. I have the numbers in front of me as well. Let me just flip over to them.
Hello, can you hear me now? Sorry about that, everybody.
There you go. Thank you for the pause. Let us get Michael on the line.
Apologize. Good morning. Good evening, everybody. My name is Michael Dowdle with T.Y. Lynn. We prepared the traffic study and supported the development application. Just quickly to build upon what Michael said through you, Mr. Chair, we did analyze, you know, what that infiltration might look like along, you know, Guild Road and Royal. And we expect approximately 5 site trips to be generated from the development to utilize that road. But it's a nominal impact to the residents in the road. And furthermore, once it's, you know, for example, don't want to confuse the two roads, but, you know, the one that's closest to the developments, which I believe is Royal Road, you know, once that is restricted to right out, we can expect even a reduction of traffic once it's converted right out to Kingston. So, you know, the volume of traffic that's shared by the site, we expect to be a nominal when compared to the overall future total traffic volume along that road.
And I think, Michael, just to add to that, I think in your worst case scenario analysis, where you assumed nobody was taking transit, which was outside of the scope, but was done just to explain the range of impact, if not a single person in the development used transit, was 11 trips during the AM peak and 20 trips on the PM peak using Royal or Gilt. So very, very minimal.
Yeah, that's correct. Thank you, Michael.
Cars and parking lots, are you offering any electric vehicle charger stations?
So the Pickering Integrated Sustainable Design Guidelines actually do require at this point 10% EV ready and 40% EV rough in. So through the site plan, that'll be provided, yes.
And last question, so I think residents were concerned in terms of the amenities. Could you speak in regards to what kind of amenities are you offering?
Certainly. So with respect to amenities, first off, there's Post Corner and the Farmstead Lane, which we spoke at great length about. I just don't want them to get lost in the conversation. But in addition to that, there's also to be proposed in the bylaw a minimum of 2 meters squared of indoor and 2 meters squared of outdoor amenity space per unit. So that'll equate to roughly 15,000 square feet of indoor and 15,000 square feet of outdoor space on the site. The outdoor space will likely occur on the sixth floor podium, so in between the mid-rise and the high-rise building and kind of overlooking Post Corner. And then in addition, staff have put into the bylaw a minimum of 3 meters squared per unit. That's private amenity space for the units, which will be in the form of balconies, or in the case of the townhomes, could also be your rooftop patios. And then in terms of the range of amenities, obviously that'll be determined through the site plan process and thereafter into the marketing. We've certainly heard from members of the community that they would like things like a prayer room. I'm passed that along to my client, and they're certainly willing to consider it as we move forward.
Great. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Any other members have questions? I just have just a couple of them, Michael. First, thank you also for advancing tonight the suggestion from what we talked about for including an art gallery designation. The second part of the that I'm curious as well, just to confirm, you also spoke to your client about the possibility that Pickering might be able to look at using Post Manor for an art gallery.
Yes, I did. Yeah, and he was very excited by the proposition.
Thank you. So are we. Thank you. You're done.
Oh, that's it? Okay.
You're done. And that brings us to the
first. Move 4.1.
Moved by Councillor Pickle, seconded by Councillor Butt, that the Director of City Development and CBO report PLN-05-23 Zoning Bylaw Amendment Application A1022 City initiated on 2570 Tillings Road, and the recommendation is for approval and for enacting the necessary bylaws. Councillor Pickles.
Thank you, Chair Brenner. So this is very exciting. We're finally moving along on this. It's been a long time coming. The community's look very much looking forward to a school in this area, and all of Pickering's looking forward to getting a new school in place. So we've got the future school site, and then we have the future park and the open space land. So through you to staff, I understand that the site's been declared clean. We're doing the rezoning here, and the next steps are site plan approval. Can you tell us where we are in site plan approval? I know there's been submissions under consideration.
Through you, Chair Brenner, we do have a site plan application under review. It's currently being circulated to the various city departments and agencies, and that we are getting comments back, and we'll be communicating those comments to the school board, and hopefully wrapping up that phase of the review process with potential construction happening later the summer, early fall.
Well, those were my next questions. The site plan, any hurdles that you see, any issues, or it's just doing due diligence at this point?
It's at this time just doing your technical due diligence. We do not anticipate any significant issues. It's just really looking at making sure grading between the school sites and our park block function well, to making sure that the park block has a good use and visibility.
So you've got the step after that is construction beginning in 2023, so that'll be great to have a groundbreaking. The school open in 2024. Somewhere before that, we got to sell them the site. So where are we on that, and when might that be in front of council?
We have had a couple of group meetings now among city staff and board staff. I've been in contact on several occasions with the board's council, who is formulating a draft agreement of purchase and sale as we speak. We have prepared and deposited a reference plan for the purposes of the pending transaction, and work on by a certified property appraiser for the city is underway so that we can determine a fair price and have as objective as possible a benchmark for determining that. The board will be doing its own appraisal as well.
And the board gets construction financing, if I'm correct, the board gets funds for the purchase of land and construction generally from the province. Is the province a party of that agreement, or we deal directly with and only with the school board?
Directly and only with the school board when it comes to the agreement of purchase and sale.
Thank you. And Mr. Chair, this is, as I said before, great news. We've talked about it a number of times. I know we're all looking forward to the school coming, certainly the people in the community, and we'll all wear our boots and come to the this sod turning and the shovels in the ground. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Pickles. Anyone else? Councillor Butt, then Councillor Robinson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I also want to I think the residents over are excited to hear. Would it be okay to break the news to say the school is coming in 2024 then?
Through you, Chair Brenner, it would be fair to say that the school is coming. Again, that is a tentative construction timeline at this particular point in time. Their hope is to break ground. It does take about 14 to 15 months to actually construct your school, but is the school board's intent to have that open by September 2024?
Okay, great. Great job done. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Councillor Robinson.
Thank you, Chair Brenner, and through you. So with the lands that are to be retained by the city, the south section of it that are going to be, we're going to change in the bylaw to be OS zone. It says here that the bylaw use, any lot or erect, alter, or use any building or structure for any purpose except for the following. And there's 2 points: A, preservation and conservation of the natural environment, and B, a stormwater management. What is the likelihood of any of those happening?
Through you, Chair Brenner, the intent of that site, because we do have a number of mature trees and there is a small little tributary there, it intended to be for long-term preservation of that site. The chances of a stormwater management being facilitated in that is highly unlikely, but it is typically a use that we do include just in the event, but it's not intended to see that facility type of built within that area.
That is great news. Thank you for the clarification. Thank you.
Any other member? Not, I'll call the question. All those in favor? It's carried. Next item. Moved by Councillor Butt, seconded by Councillor Cook. And the recommendation is for the official plan amendment application, OPA 20-008P, and zoning bylaw amendment
application.
Moved by Mayor. I'm having a hard night today. I know that. I almost did. It's reading too much of the stuff on Facebook. It's killing me. It is moved by Mayor Ash and seconded by Councillor Pickles. Dispense with the reading. All those in favor? Carried. That's what happens. It's a long, long day. Mayor Ash, of course.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to speak in favor of this motion. As some members of council would know, when this came before statutory meeting over a year ago, obviously, I had a conflict because I lived right next door to this building, and now I don't. But I want to speak to a couple of things. One, the preservation of the heritage home on that facility. I'm excited about the opportunity to create a community. I know they're working with the tenants for a significantly period of time in regards to leases. That particular plaza does need a facelift, and I think renewal is good. It is on a transit corridor, so I think that's where we should be building. And I think two towers down to one was respectful of some of the concerns expressed by the community. So I'm going to support the recommendation tonight and thank the applicant and his planning team for thoughtful and respectful process that they took with the community. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mayor. Anyone else? My comment, obviously, I am going to be supporting this. I too would like to thank the applicant because, in a sense, they have now raised another benchmark. One of the things that was really striking that stood out was the incorporation of the heritage history into the entire proposal. And I know it's definitely challenging to take a high rise and stack townhouses and put it into a layout, but you did do that. And the fact that you were even open-minded enough to consider even going a little bit further in terms of a gateway community to look at opening the door for dialogue with the city of Pickering for a badly needed art gallery, I think is just amazing. And I want to thank you for that as well. On that, just one quick direction to staff. You don't need any amendment tonight, but you can take it as direction to incorporate into the draft zoning that comes back, the uses to include the an art gallery.
That is correct. We will amend the bylaw when it comes back to the March council meeting to include an art gallery / studio. So in the future, if the city is looking to open up a gallery, it could be used on anywhere on the site.
Excellent. Thank you. The other comment, which is, and I don't know if it's coincidental or not, but when you look at some of our gateways, and we have this on Brock, which is a gateway going up Brock, a gateway coming into Pickering. Go a little bit further over, we have a heritage building known as the former Liverpool House, where we've had some challenges and applications that have been up and down and up and down. But I'm hoping that the same kind of recognition of heritage is given to all of our gateways. And that includes when we're looking at Altona Road, where unfortunately somebody jump-started and butchered a heritage location, that this now starts a chain reaction to start showing the kind of respect for our heritage that this applicant has shown. And I thank you for that. And if there's nobody else, I'll call the question. All those in favor, it's carried unanimously. And that brings us to other business. Nobody? I'll take an adjournment motion.
Motion to adjourn.
Moved by Councillor Cook, seconded by Councillor Nagy to adjourn. All those in favor, and it's carried. Thank you very much. Good night, everyone.